Welcome to Buddha at the Gas Pump. My name is Rick Archer, and my guest today is Laurie Moore in person. We're out at the Science and Non-Duality Conference in California. Outdoors, obviously. You're going to hear a jet or two going over, maybe. I interviewed Laurie about a year ago, and we exchanged a few emails before I came out to the conference, and she indicated that her thinking had evolved over the course of a year, and that, you know, we might want to have a conversation while we're out here. I probably will be doing two or three other interviews while we're out here also, so you'll be seeing those. So, Laurie, welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for driving over. So what's changed in the past year?
Well, you know, when I spoke to you last, my main message and my main invitation to people was simply to return to this depth of love, this depth of peace, this depth in which there can be a resonance and experience of the connectedness of all and everything. And fundamentally, I still feel that's what we're called back to, what we yearn for, and to be so focused on that that it overlooks the reality of the many other aspects of consciousness that we have to operate in to live in at this time is a bit of a oversight, or a bit of an escape, or a bit of a denial. And so now, when people are coming to dialogue with me and they want assistance or they want help, and they're really pointing to some aspect of consciousness in which they're revolving, in which they're living, I tend to just value whatever aspect of consciousness they're experiencing and go from that point.
So you're saying that earlier on you were focusing on the kind of the unmanifest quality to the exclusion of the manifest, and now you've broadened your kind of a territory, so to speak,
yeah,
to incorporate the whole gamut, the whole range more fully.
More so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is actually a traditional hang-up I've been discovering, because it's one of the themes that comes up frequently in interviews, and so I've, you know, looked at it from different angles there. Even back in the Upanishads, there's some verse in the Chandogya Upanishad, I think, where some sage says to someone, you know, this Brahman of yours is only one-footed. In other words, you've only kind of like grokked the absolute value of it, and you haven't really incorporated the full range. And I think it's something that's endemic in the non-dual community these days. And it's also something that many non-dual teachers, such as Jeff Foster and Bentinho, Massaro, and others, have kind of progressed through and then out of.
Yeah, well, we obviously live in many states of consciousness, both as individuals and ourselves,
mm-hmm,
and how we participate and cooperate with each other. And right now, probably a lot of us are rethinking about our overall government system of how we participate with each other. What have we bred from our choice to be a capitalistic society? And I'm not here really to comment on capitalism or socialism. I have my own views, but we have to look at what have we bred, you know, from what we've chosen. And if spirituality becomes something that we need to separate ourselves in a community, or separate ourselves solo, or deny a lot of what's going on around us, what good does it do? If it doesn't bring us back to kindness and an intelligence that evolves us into a system that's serving everybody, what's the point?
Yeah. So you're saying spirituality is not a sort of a pie-in-the-sky sort of thing. It has pragmatic application, or it should.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I found with myself that when I was in a lot of states of oneness, when that grace had taken me there, it consumed me, and I felt that's all that mattered.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't fully meet challenges that came to me in my personal life that I had to attend to.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, hey, you know, wait a minute. There's kind of a humbling about that. People are in all kinds of situations and need to focus on, as I was saying, the consciousness in which they are needing to operate in any moment. In a whole day, you might have to be in different states of consciousness. So when we start to idealize spirituality and talk about oneness or unconditional, there's many moments during the day when that's not where we are.
Mm-hmm.
And when we're challenged by certain interactions or situations, whether they're personal or societal or family. And then what is so important is how do we work with the oneness state, that deep oneness state, and the reality of duality that's included?
Would you say that it's not an either-or situation, that it's not like you have to be either in oneness or dealing with practical matters, but you can, and this is sort of a leading question because obviously this is what I believe, but that you can integrate and stabilize oneness and enjoy that state? And well, there's a verse in the Gita that says, yogastar kuru karmani, which means established in yoga, which means oneness,
yeah.
Perform action.
Yes.
So established in it, not like enjoy it for a while, lose it, and get into action, but living
yes.
in oneness,
yes.
do what needs to be done.
Yes, and that's always, for me, that's always been the goal, to deepen, and then to bring that out into the world, into the service, into mm-hmm. the interaction in which I live.
Yeah. I'm going to be interviewing Llewellyn von Lee later this next month, I guess, and he's written a book about spiritual ecology. And at the last SAND conference, there was this sort of interesting dialogue that took place between two other teachers. I won't name names at this point, but you know, one of them was saying, "The world is an illusion. You know, what is it? Ecological issues don't really interest me." And the other guy was saying, "They've got to interest you, you know. I mean, it's important, you know, and we shouldn't use non-duality as a way of, you know, de-emphasizing
yeah.
critical problems." And in fact, I think this is going to be Llewellyn's point in that interview, in fact, spiritual awakening may very well be the critical component that can bring solutions to these problems ultimately.
For me, I always was interested in the world. I was interested in ecology. I was interested in cross-cultural relations and world peace. And I was always based in a deeper place that felt like the foundation. And certainly, there's a perspective and a seeing that I see a lot of the time where I see everything's just floating by. We're all imagining. We're giving value to things that have no value. We're passing through. All that's happening is some sensations, some motions, and sounds. And in the depth of my heart, I experience that as true, and I participate in a world where everyone's affected.
Mm-hmm.
And if everyone's not eating, something's wrong with the whole group. If everyone's not getting good health care, something's wrong with the whole group. If it's destroying the plants and the animals so that the earth no longer is in a harmonious existence, we have problems. And so I would say, like you, that as more and more people return to this deeper state in the heart, to this place of unconditional, we have solutions that can come that we don't even know yet.
Mm-hmm.
That to live more in a question of not knowing is a really great thing. I've been in so many spiritual communities where this deep peace is valued, and then I observe horrible behaviors, like cutthroat behaviors. So I'm thinking, well, what's the point of this if it's not kindness, if it's not learning to respect one another?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's that? Who was it? John Donne wrote that poem, and the famous lines, you know, "No man is an island," and then a little bit later, "Ask not for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee." Meaning, if, like you just said, somebody's starving, somebody's being forced into prostitution, you know, as a child, or, you know, all these horrible things that happen in the world, it's, like it or not, ultimately we can't isolate ourselves from these things. Even if you think you're isolating yourself, it's actually you that is happening to on some deep level.
Yes, and how we deal with all these challenges is really overwhelming and perplexing. And I know for myself, many times I would wake up in the morning and say, you know, I don't know what to do about it all.
Mm-hmm.
And so, of course, we each have a role that we're drawn to. We don't know why. It's a mystery. We end up doing actions and participating in a way unique to each of our personalities. But we're part of this big system. And for me, I personally feel very challenged right now by I am part of a big system. Yes, I would like to wake up every day and just meditate and share with people. And I was doing that for a while, and then I said, hey, I can't pay my bills.
Mm.
And so then I went back to doing some like promotion, quote unquote, and I didn't feel good about it. You know, I felt something inside me got a little more jaded because my mind was in a different place. But then I thought, well, I'm being really blatantly honest here on the mm-hmm. on the internet, because I'm assuming a lot of people go through this kind of thing. And then I thought, okay, well then, I'll just go back. I'll keep praying and meditating that I just stay in this state. And you know, so many teachers say that will just guide you and it will all be done. Well, that's not my experience or many I need to take care of myself in the world of duality, and mm-hmm. my wish would be for everyone to have that opportunity.
Mm. So, sounds kind of like this is still a work in progress for you, or have you resolved this to a great extent?
The resolution, it's a work in process. The resolution is a lot of humbling and forgiveness for the great imperfection of participating as a human.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that your perspective shifted a lot in the past year. Was there some event or something which precipitated that, or was it just a kind of a natural, gradual, incremental maturation that began to dawn on you that this?
It shifted because originally I wanted to take as much of the 12 months in silence. I had planned that.
Oh, yeah, I remember you saying that. Yeah.
Yeah, I had planned it like a gift to myself. Mm-hmm. And then so many things occurred it would have been kind of foolish to do that. I had mm-hmm. to attend to practical matters.
Yeah.
But in that time, the beginning where I had some time in a lot of silence, I started to note different states of consciousness that I was cycling through.
Hmm.
And one state was the first one that we've addressed. There's just all. There's no word for it. There's no difference between me and that book and you and my thought. Then there is another state where there's creation and there's an impetus and there's an intention. And then there's another state where words get added to that as a mode of an expression. And then there's another state where you're a little lost because you've gone more into the words than the state. And then there's actions that come from the words, and then you can just be really lost in all of that,
mm.
which can be fine. There are good people doing wonderful things in that illusion. And then I noticed the unconditional states, like the unconditional peace state and the unconditional joy state, like flavors. There were different yeah. qualities within that. But then I said, what societies had really done well with each other? People who just went into the oneness state, or people who were also perfecting very practical states? And
mm-hmm.
so really valuing and thinking about Ken Wilber's work and how he pointed out how so all this is necessary and affects how evolution occurs.
Yeah. The thought that I keep coming back to as you're talking is that it doesn't have to be an either-or situation. That the name of the game really is to grow in the ability to simultaneously function in all these states or stage or levels, if we want to call them levels, because each has its significance and its importance. Dealing with certain specific practical matters or worldly problems or whatever is not a cop-out. It's not like if you're going to do that, then you're not serious about non-duality or something.
Not at all.
And in fact, it's, what was it? I think Thoreau said, go ahead and build castles in the air. That's where they belong. Just put foundations under them. So this non-dual state that we're all talking about, that this conference is about, is really the foundation.
Yes.
And I totally. Well, go ahead and respond to that.
One of my favorite mentors, Gangaji's invitation, has always rung very true with me, because no matter what I'm doing or how I'm serving or participating, when I fully open myself to the sensational experience within that, it seems to just melt.
Mm-hmm.
I'm back in the oneness, but I'm not removing myself from the participation.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that as we delve deeper into this foundational piece that is the basis of us and remain in the participation, if that's our calling. Some people's calling is to remove themselves, and I support that 100%. We have to go with whatever we're called to. We find that the fabric, the quality, the way in which we relate carries a deeper resonance of peace. But what I began to question for the first time this last year was, does it carry a deeper resonance of kindness and cooperation and what's needed in duality? Because in duality, which does exist, we each have a separate ego, and we each have the opportunity to keep noting what our own personality is stuck on or assuming for our own narcissistic needs. That's true of everyone. There's so many need after need out of subtle need that can affect what we believe is right or true. That's the invitation on Earth, to keep letting more and more of that go, to keep noting more and more of that, mm-hmm. and to stay in a deepening place of the peace is a great, it's a great opportunity that we have.
Well, there's quite a couple of questions in there. One is, how do we stay there? You know, because people find that they get caught up in worldly concerns and they lose it, you know. And we're talking here about simultaneously being in that state while dealing with the worldly concerns. So what ways have you found to kind of integrate and stabilize the simultaneity of the depth and the surface values of life?
I started using prayer a lot more. I was a natural meditator from childhood. I would just go into these deep states where I had to be in silence. I had no choice. I loved it. And I've always been like that. And meditation wasn't a practice. It's just what I love.
Just came naturally to you.
But prayer was what I need. I felt was, for me, what I started using more and more this last year as the meeting point between any contradiction I could find. Basically just asking for help. Oh, now I'm really frustrated. I'm not at all what I'm preaching. Help!
Yeah. So by prayer, you sort of mean not just having the sort of the deep non-dual awareness, but introducing specific intentions into that,
yeah.
or specific desires or requests.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And have you found that fruitful?
I have. I have not found it to be as quiet and silent as just the simple meditation silent state that's so lovingly, wonderfully there to just drop into. But I have found it to be raising me to more honest level of what I'm not and what in me is not at all that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's brought like just great joy and compassion for just about everyone, because it's a lot of judgments I had on myself, and when you have judgments on yourself, they get extended to others, even if quietly. Expectations kind of started to wilt, and I just saw, wow, I don't know who anyone is. I'm just here with each person in the moment. See what we are in this moment.
Yeah. Interesting thing. You know, if we pray, let's say, from surface level of the mind, then it's going to have a certain effect. Like maybe, you know, to use an example from physics, like if you take a pebble and throw it, it's going to have a certain effect. But if you can pray from the deeper levels of the mind or deeper levels of being or whatever, and those are intrinsically far more powerful.
Yeah.
And so it's like taking, although this has a destructive implication, which is not what I intend, but if you could unleash the sort of atomic or nuclear level of energy of that pebble, you know, it could probably fuel an entire city for a year or something if you could really extract all the energy from it. So I think what you're suggesting is that, you know, you've since childhood had recourse to deep oneness level of awareness, whatever we want to call it, but now you've been kind of more intentionally entertaining desires or intentions on that deeper level, and thereby perhaps having having those be much more impactful than if you were just sort of entertaining at some surface level. No, I mean to put words in your mouth.
Yeah, I would say you're talking about the level of creation,
mm-hmm.
and I feel that what the adjustment for me was using my creation more for kind of just more of an acceptance of, okay, I had this idea, I was born in the 60s, I thought we were creating world peace. I don't even know what world peace is now. I thought in 2012 it was like we made mistakes and then we were going to solve it. Now that seems really simplistic to me, but somehow that's what I thought, and then I thought when Obama was elected,
that was going to solve it.
Or like everyone was going to come forward with all these new solutions, so things didn't turn out as I planned.
So it
took me back to, okay, well, the only universe I can contribute to is the one I'm standing in right now. And I have no idea what this is, this earth, this enactment, this time in history, and the whole giant, all the planets, solar systems, how it's going to turn out. But that I had to operate more from, rather than this expectation, like we are going to have this happen. And created, and we'll all love each other, and everyone will be full of respect and goodness, and I have no idea except now. All I can do is turn to what feels to be the most important intention for this moment now, with no idea of what's going to happen.
Yeah, and what I get from that is that, you know, you've kind of realized that you're not running the universe. you're not, and so. you know, don't usurp a role which is not yours, which even having such expectations is doing in a way, but kind of like fully surrender to the role which is yours, which will be shown to you in each stage of the game.
Yeah, and I did think we were a giant web, so it wasn't so much that, you know, my desire would play out, but I thought so many people were here to bring about a new shift, a new ecology, a new political way, new ways. Of course, there are new ways, but there's so much destruction going on right now. It just, my ideal was just naive.
Yeah.
It wasn't what happened.
Well, you know, it's happening, I think, but it's got its own time schedule. I was talking to Menos Kafatos this morning at breakfast. He's a physicist, and he was talking about scientists such as Stephen Hawking, who are kind of atheistic, and there are certain things which bug the hell out of them about what physics understands about the universe, because it shakes their atheism. And I forget, I'll interview him and we'll get into it in detail, and I can't do justice to what he was saying, but basically one of the principles was the sort of multiverse principle. There's some things about this universe that we live in which are just so miraculously right. And if things were off by just one little iota, one to so many zeros difference, the universe wouldn't work. And so it implies that there's an intelligence governing the universe.
Yeah.
And this really scares people for whom that paradigm doesn't fit. And so they've come up with this multiverse theory that there must be like a practically infinite number of universes, and just by chance, like monkeys typing, and enough monkeys typing to produce, one of them producing Shakespeare, just by chance we happen to live in a universe which is kind of worked out. So there is no intelligence involved. It's just we're kind of lucky. We lucked out that this one sort of works out of all the duds. But what Manos and I were agreeing upon is that intelligence is everywhere. And if there are multiple universes, those are working out too and are governed by the same intelligence governing this one. And what I'm getting at in a roundabout way, bear with me, I had coffee for the first time in a year this morning, because I didn't sleep much last night because I got in late, is he said that corporations are actually kind of surreptitiously funding some of these atheists who are espousing this kind of insentient, non-intelligent view of the universe. And we were thinking, why would they do that? You know, they don't do anything except for profit, and so why would they feel that the propagation of the notion that we're swimming in a sea of intelligence would jeopardize their profit in some way? And the thought was perhaps that if enough people wake up to that understanding based upon their experience, not just philosophically, it's going to produce a sea change in collective consciousness. And if collective consciousness shifts sufficiently, there are all kinds of very entrenched things which you and I would agree don't deserve to exist, which are going to have the rug pulled out from under them, and which will have a very difficult time existing. So, I mean, so many aspects of our economy really have no purpose of any kind of, you know, benign, in any benign sense. They're just destructive of life. I mean, the Keystone Pipeline, the cigarette industry, the alcohol industry, I mean, just the gun industry. So many things we could mention, you know, they're just destructive of life. And if consciousness were raised enough, they would have no reason to exist. And consciously or unconsciously, the perpetrators of those things perhaps realize that they're being threatened by a change in society, which will, you know, I've gone on long enough, but...
Thank you for going on about hope and faith in a way, because you're saying that as more and more people recognize the immense intelligence, it's mind-boggling how everything works, how a plant grows, how you and I are talking, how you even got, and I even got here. I mean, 100 years ago, you and I would not know we exist, and here we are in San Jose, you live in Iowa, you know, talking about this.
Yeah.
We're so fortunate, and as more and more people are in touch with the bounty and grace and just what can be created when we tune in to this the gift of life and the intelligence running everything, and it is benevolent. And I mean, I've seen so many unexplainable synchronicities and goodness, and that, yes, we can create human participation at large in a much different way.
Yeah. So, you know, what you were saying a few minutes ago about being kind of naively optimistic, and, you know, maybe Obama's going to do it, maybe this is going to do it, everything's going to change by, you know, such as 2012 or something like that. I'm not saying just that to you, but to people in general, I don't think we should, just because those hopes and dreams don't pan out on our timeline, don't get pessimistic.
No, a million years from now is fine.
I'm not thinking a million. I'm thinking in our lifetime, there's still going to be massive change.
Good.
And we're seeing symptoms of it. And the pace of it seems to be accelerating exponentially.
Yeah.
You know,
there's a lot of good being grown. I've been feeling a little cynical lately, but I'm bouncing back right as we speak.
Good.
Yeah.
I mean, the evidence is there. It's just this thing I said about the corporations, you know, even they're aware of it.
Yeah.
People who you wouldn't expect to sort of be aware of such things are feeling, beginning to feel threatened.
Yeah.
You know, that's a good sign.
Yeah.
And I mean,
and we never know who's going to jump out of the woodwork and change their mind. I mean, somebody who's put themselves in a position to influence many or have power in a way that is destructive can suddenly, that same degree of energy they're using, sometimes people switch, they flip.
Yeah.
Something changes them, and all that energy they've grown is suddenly used in the opposite direction for good.
Yeah. And social changes sometimes happen quite abruptly. I mean, look at the fall of the Berlin Wall, the collapse of the Soviet Union. If those were beneficial Soviet, well, they seem to have been beneficial, at least the collapse of the Berlin Wall. And, you know, it's like people sort of have they take for granted that the world they live in is kind of the way it's always been and always will be. You know, but if, as you were just alluding to, if we're to go back 100 years and look at what we're doing now today and that jet flying over, we think, where am I? This is like a whole futuristic thing, but you know, but we take it for granted. So what might it be like 50 years from now, 100 years from now?
I would love to imagine that it's a world where everyone has food and everyone has shelter and everyone has health care in every country and everyone has freedom of expression and everyone has an ability and everyone is consciously considering kindness and care and thoughtfulness and respect among all species an important value.
Mm.
That's so simple. If every single person, speaking of prayer and intention, if for the next 10 minutes every single person on the globe decided that was more important than anything, that could happen within 24 hours, I'm convinced.
Yeah, but then you're getting pie in the sky again, because everybody in the world isn't going to do that for the next 10 minutes. It's kind of going to grow in a more organic, natural way, and there will still be people doing creepy things, but there's kind of a groundswell that's growing.
Yeah, and sometimes when lots and lots of people build something together, the change comes later. My father and I were talking, he's in his 80s, so I've been making a point to talk to him more and more about his life, because he won't be around forever. And he worked for the Kennedy administration, and he was reminiscing about Martin Luther King's march, and how it might not have happened, and how it did happen, and just the tremendous energy that came of that, and the waves and repercussions years later. And so as you speak, I'm thinking about how when we really join together, lots of us, with a particular intention, how it can abruptly shift something, and that the goodness of that can come about wave after wave for years to come.
Ew. What was that thing Margaret Mead said about, you know, a small group of committed individuals? Remember that quote?
I know what you mean, like the 100th monkey kind of thing.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's like, that's what actually does bring about change. It's usually not a top-down kind of thing, probably never, where somehow everybody at once does such and such, like sits for the next 10 minutes. But it's more kind of like a small percentage starts doing something, and then 100th monkey thing.
Yeah.
It propagates. And you know, that gets us back to where we were half an hour ago, which is that if that small percentage is working from a more fundamental level, then they have leverage. You know, Whereas on the political level, on the macroeconomic level, those seem powerful to us, but that's not actually where the leverage is.
Well, isn't it true where you live in Fairfield, Iowa, with all the meditators, that the crime rate has went down drastically when all the meditation started?
Yeah, not just in Fairfield, but they've done all these experiments where I was part of it, where we went to, you know, places like Iran just before the Shah left, and Nicaragua and certain trouble spots, Israel, and there was a war going on with Lebanon at that time, and they did all sorts of statistical analysis, and I mean, maybe they were using the research as a PR thing, but it actually got published in some peer-reviewed journals, and the skeptics couldn't debunk it. But apparently, you know, there was a clear correlation between these large groups of people meditating in these places and reduction in war deaths and crimes and all kinds of other social indicators. And, we're just sitting in a hotel or whatever with our eyes closed, so it's not like we were intermingling with the population and smiling at them or something. It was more like we were effecting a change in an underlying field which propagated throughout the environment and resulted in, you know, in a very organic, deep way, changes in behavioral patterns of the people who shared that field.
When I work with people, I now work in my home. I worked in offices for years just so I can be in a certain energy field. Mm-hmm. And if a lot of people report a similar kind of challenge at the same time, I look to any place in myself where I can make a shift. Mm-hmm. And I make the shift, and I find that people come in and they make the shift. Mm-hmm. It's not, and I don't want this to be understood, I didn't make their shift. There's something about energy when we go to the deepest source of our intention, when we go back to that place of peace, mm-hmm. rather than talking about it or how are we going to fix it. That's secondary and that's needed. But fundamentally changing an energetic intention, and you have a group of people going to this deep peace, others didn't know, but then the research showed that many situations changed around that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, so I guess one question might be, you know, what will be the tipping point for the world if we really want to see, will there be a tipping point, or will it just be sort of a gradual, continual, you know, change, or could there come a time when, you know, we have a global equivalent of the Berlin Wall falling, or, you know, Soviet Union collapsing, you know, where there's just sort of this massive shift on a global level at a certain point when enough momentum has been built up.
And maybe there'll be maybe by necessity a lot more community will start to happen. I know in the 70s and 80s I lived in lots of communities, communes, spiritual communities. Maybe by necessity physically, mm-hmm. That will start to happen, that people will have to rely on each other more in those ways. I mean, I see that sprouting up. I've seen a lot of countries where people have started to create more community type living now. And maybe from those power sources, different of that kind of power, kind of peaceful power, mm-hmm. all over, more and more of those will give rise to something more global.
Yeah. And, you know, we're speaking a little bit hypothetically here, but I think, you know, there are examples of this stuff happening.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not entirely maybe. It's like, you know, it's building up.
Yeah, if you Google intentional community, there's a kind of new intentional community growing all over the... maybe a resurgence of what was happening in the 60s and 70s and in many places, in many countries right now.
Yeah. Huh. Okay. Well, what else shall we touch upon in the time remaining? We've been kind of going around the same point from various angles, but is there anything any kind of angle we haven't really dealt with that you'd like to...
Well, I do want to just reemphasize that if we want world peace, if we want new structures, if we want a different way of harmonizing with one another, it really does come down to how we interact within ourselves and thus towards others. Because there is somewhat of a war in each human, I think, inherently, that we're born with. There are aspects of each of ourselves that will not be preferable to others, and there are aspects to ourselves that will cause pain for ourselves. And so really looking to honestly face, embrace, heal, be present with those aspects of ourselves, maybe just quietly. We don't need to tell everyone what they are. We can have forums, and that can be healing too. Either way is vital, is to me very, very important.
Yeah. I mean, to me it seems self-evident, and I take it for granted, but individual peace is the unit of world peace.
Yeah.
you know? And we kind of looked at political reasons why there isn't peace here and there, and economic reasons. And those things have their relevancy, as we said in the beginning, and perhaps things need to be done on those levels. But if things are merely done on those levels without individual peace somehow being established, it's probably a fool's errand, you know?
It becomes philosophy. And back to when I thought Obama getting in, it wasn't that I thought Obama would do it. I thought this is a reflection of where we
have higher consciousness,
so many people, and he will represent so many people. And I'm not commenting anything on Obama. Everyone's very complicated. He's a human being. But I thought he's the reflection of so many
something
of us
good
ready
is happening
for something
if he's getting
different.
In. Yeah,
that each of us is doing such deep work.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I was saying to Francis, Francis is sitting here, Francis Bennett, that, you know, maybe it wasn't you, but that you could put Jesus Christ in the presidency and it would still be a flop in many respects, just because the leader of any nation is to such a great degree governed by the collective consciousness of that nation.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. And so what has happened since has to do with everyone. And
yeah,
it's not
exactly.
Where I thought everyone
it's
wanted to go.
It's not some leader can do the whole thing.
Oh, no, not at all. No.
I live in Iowa, you know, and all the politicians come through Iowa, and we see them on a real nitty-gritty level because it's the first caucus in the country and the first, you know, all that. So I've had the opportunity to run into Obama 3 times now and ask him a couple of questions. And the last time I said to him, I said, "We love you. Don't let the turkeys get you down." And he laughed. And he said, "There's a lot of them out there, and they just keep on gobbling."
He has a hard job.
Yeah.
Really hard.
They say the presidency is like trying to drink from a fire hose. You know, there's so much coming at you.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the point for this interview is that a leader like that can only do so much given the collective consciousness of the nation he's trying to govern.
Yeah. And so that brings us back to ourselves, because of course we like to think about the globe and society and the country. I do, but I'm responsible for what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling, and how I'm artistically interacting with that. And what we are thinking and feeling, you know, a lot of people say we can't control what we're thinking and feeling. We can't control it, but what our basis is, I've noticed in my body and mind, the basis of my interaction with the universe, with the light, with whatever you want to call my source, with the source, is affecting greatly the thoughts, feelings, and physical sensations that then go through me as a being all day long. And I consider them to be barometers and thermometers of where am I embedding my deepest intention. So if my deepest intention is world peace, which has to be personal peace, my thoughts and feelings and the physical sensations inside me greatly reflect that. And this is not a popular thing to say, because it can be misinterpreted as I'm blaming people for their illnesses, which I'm not at all. Because I did go through a few years where I was severely ill and I didn't know if I would live. And it was very unexpected because I had a very healthy lifestyle. But what I learned from it, because I had to intricately interact with my own thoughts and feelings quietly in states that had contained very uncomfortable feelings, was my thoughts and feelings were very much affected by where I was embedding my deepest intentions. And little things I didn't notice throughout the day, little conversations I might be having in my mind that were not peaceful, where I brought in other people into my imagination, would actually take place in my body as a sensation that could be very uplifting and healing, or could be very painful. And a lot of the work I've done with people where they've experienced these deep emotional healings and said there's been physical results has come from that understanding that we're operating a machine. Our soul is placed in a machine, and all day long we're putting effects on it that's going to cause physical or emotional or mental turmoil or peace. And once again, I'm not blaming anyone for their illnesses. We're all going to have emotional and physical disharmonies that we can reshift by where we're embedding our basic consciousness and our intention.
Yeah. And you can be the most enlightened guy in the world and still get cancer.
Of course.
Some of the Ramana Maharshi died of cancer.
Course.
And some of these other ones. So it doesn't mean that, you know, he did something bad.
Not at all.
Anything else. I mean, the body is the body, and it's felt it's vulnerable to yes. all kinds of things.
Yes, and the body has genetic imprints, and yeah. but there's an opportunity, regardless of the outcome. What I had to do is I had to interact with myself at deeper and deeper levels of what I experienced as peace. And my conversations had to be more and more positive and with everything, my private inner conversations. And I just kept measuring and noticing the differences in how I was experiencing life as a result of that. That thoughts I might say, oh, these thoughts just passed through my mind. But what I was focused on most of my time in my life affects the thoughts that are passing through my mind. That's my responsibility. Then if I have a great life, or I have a challenging life, or I get cancer, I'm the healthiest person in the world, that's secondary. I wish for everyone to be healthy, and I wish for a great life for everyone. But going back repeatedly to what I am valuing, beyond what I say I'm valuing, proved important. It showed me that this is an instrument, a biofeedback instrument.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I forgot what I was going to say. But, okay.
And as everybody's shifting these biofeedback instruments, then we see a shift in more around us and what we perceive, who we attract, what's going on, what we think's happening.
Yeah, I remember what I was going to say, which is that, you know, if God, if you wish to use that word, or intelligence, you know, really is sort of omnipresent, then it permeates every cell, every particle of our being, and nothing is happening arbitrarily or capriciously. And another thought to throw in, if there really is a sort of a evolutionary purpose to creation, then ultimately everything is in service of that evolutionary purpose. And if it doesn't appear to be so, then you're just not zoomed back far out enough to see the perspective of that intelligence which is orchestrating all this. So I think this relates to your point, where if, you know, various things that you go through and difficulties or illnesses or, you know, stuff that you find within yourself, all that is sort of instrumental ultimately in the evolution of this instrument, I think you used the word instrument, to serve that greater purpose.
Yeah, instrumental is the word. Yeah. Artistically instrumental is the word. Mm-hmm. And that's so well put.
Now, let's talk about animals for a minute. Because
okay.
In our last interview, that's mostly what we talked about. And you and I kept going back and forth, and we couldn't agree.
Yeah.
And I thought about this over the past year, and you mentioned Ken Wilber earlier. You know, from what I have read of Ken Wilber, I like listening to him, I like his work. And one of his things that he talks about is what he calls the pre-trans fallacy, and pre-rational, trans-rational. And the way he describes it, as I understand it, is that animals and children and, you know, have characteristics of innocence and spontaneity and even wisdom that seem very much like enlightenment. But they're actually in a pre-rational stage of development, and that on the other side of the development of rationality, we have the trans-rational phase, where you might find saints, to take it to the greatest extreme, who also have that innocence and wisdom and spontaneity. But they've traversed a whole range of development, which the animals and the children and whatnot have not yet traversed. And yet the two can often be mistaken or interposed. It can, you know, Christ said something about be like little children or you won't enter the kingdom of heaven. But he didn't mean going back to a pre-rational phase of development. He meant, like, the, you know, in a trans-rational way, developing the kind of innocence and spontaneity that children and animals display. So that was my conclusion about your whole thing with animals, is that I kind of felt like perhaps you were, you know, succumbing to the pre-trans fallacy in assuming that animals have this sort of enlightened status. And I can think of rebuttals to what I'm saying right now that even I would agree with, so I'm not saying this is some kind of a put-down or an absolute.
Yeah,
you know,
I understand what you're saying, that it could be sensibly concluded that animals are spontaneous and children are spontaneous just because of an innocence, because they haven't developed through all the developmental stages, that at the quote-unquote highest stage, maybe a saint or a master would now exhibit this innocence, this spontaneity, but from a very different conscious place. But I would just ask people to stay in the question of, do you really know who anyone is? And is it possible that a very evolved soul might show up in a giraffe, a person, an ant, and someone that looks quite evolved to you because they talk the talk? And you'll find that around all the kind of spiritual new age seminars, satsangs, communities. Some people talk the talk, and if you really watch what they're doing and what their intentions are, they're not so great.
They're schmucks.
Okay, thank you. Did you hear Barry Black's prayers for the White House? No. You'll love that. Okay. I'll send you that. But, so my experience, having talked to many animals and people, is that there's different souls and different states of evolution in all kinds of bodies.
Okay.
Plants, animals, people.
Now, would you say that all animals, every squirrel, every whatever, is some kind of enlightened being in an animal body? Or would you say that it's just something that can happen and occasionally you run into them?
I would say no, not every animal is in that state, but all animals are in a more aware state of their connectedness to all life. They're working at different levels of service or ego or something else, but all animals are in an aware state of their connectedness to all life. No animal is fantasizing or imagining that they are separate, that their personality is all that matters, that their small world is all that matters.
Okay, I don't have a problem with that. I saw an article in the paper the other day about chickens being much more intelligent than we have realized.
Yes.
And did you see that?
Not the chickens, but it's coming out about more and more species, the ravens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the implication was we shouldn't be putting them in these horrible little confinement coops, you know, and raising them as just sort of products. They should be treated with compassion because they're more intelligent than we realize.
Yeah, well, there's an anthropological question that if you go to another country and they have very different customs and you assume you understand and you're not understanding at all the depth behind those customs, the meaning behind those customs. So what we're finding out more and more about animals is we don't speak their language. They're observing ours, domestic animals are. Mm-hmm. We're not speaking all the intricacies. Their languages are just as complicated, their intelligence just as, I mean, whales' IQs are way off our charts, right? Yeah. And I believe they're going to find that out about cats and chickens and rabbits and everyone in time. We're just not observant enough. If you observe any animal, a cat will meow in so many different ways. They have a language. Mm. They have body language. We just missed it. We think we're smarter. I think we're probably at the lowest level of intelligence of most of the animals.
Well, here's where we start to differ. And that's because, you know, when you pass through the rational phase, going from pre-rational to trans-rational, it's a minefield because you're given free will. And, you know, you are able to separate yourself from nature. And you begin to make choices and you can really screw up, and we do as a species. But it's kind of like teenagers, you know, which they're doing okay when they're little kids, and then they get in the teenage phase, they start taking drugs and doing all these crazy things and just self-destructive, and then hopefully they make it through that phase and get a little bit more responsible again. So human beings are kind of like that. They're in the teenage phase.
Yeah.
But that is not to say that animals are in the adult phase. They're still in the innocent children phase, having not gone through their teenage years of evolution, metaphorically speaking.
Well, two things. I'm not sure that animals aren't faced with ethical choices. Animals contemplate, animals face choices. It is different than humans. And another I want to bring up is that I've been in a state sometimes where it is clear to me that we're actually not making as many choices as we think. And I know I'm contradicting something I said before because I don't live in that state. And maybe Ramana lived in that state. And I'm very rarely in that state. But there's sometimes I'm in a state where it's pretty clear that I have not chosen anything, nothing.
Right.
However, in duality, I have to live as a responsible person.
Yeah.
And that's a mystery to me how these different states exist at once, but they do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In duality, you do make choices. You know, in a certain realm of creation, we do have egos,
yeah.
No matter how cosmic we are. And we make choices with them and face consequences of those choices.
Yes.
and so on.
It appears that way from one perspective. Yeah. And then from another state in consciousness, it appears something very different is going on, that there's a source that's floating through everything and mm-hmm. has designed each being very differently. And the being doesn't have so much say in what they are as we tend to think.
Mm.
I don't know that I could argue it. I can only observe the mystery and stay open to what comes into my consciousness.
You know, what you're saying earlier about this being an instrument and refining the instrument and serving more fully with this instrument and so on. As an instrument, you know, it's a very sophisticated compared to that of a chicken. You know, I mean, your prefrontal cortex and the whole nervous system and everything is far more sophisticated and a complex and evolved instrument than, you know, that of a chicken who just has this little garbanzo brain, and very much more primitive nervous system by comparison. So, but you know, that is not to say that the consciousness of the chicken fundamentally is any different than the consciousness of Laurie and all the rest, all the human beings. We're all one consciousness.
Yes.
But that consciousness, you know, a phrase I've said a million times, we're all sense organs of the infinite. And there's the chicken sense organ, and there's the human sense organ, and there's the cow sense organ. And all these sense organs have different functions. And in a sense, you know, the eyes are no more important than the nose, no more important than the ears. They all just serve different purposes. So on some level, all these things have their importance.
Yeah, and the Mayans thought that the highest stage of evolution before you were not in a body anymore and you were in a star was that you would be a tree or a plant, where you didn't make choices of will. You couldn't be distracted in any way. You had reached such a state of awakenedness that you were just placed in a body that's completely supported that.
Hmm. I guess maybe I have a Hindu bias, you know, having grown up in, spiritually speaking, in a, you know, from a Hindu thing, you know, TM. I remember Maharshi once saying, people were asking about vegetarianism, and he's saying, if you have to eat someone, then eat lesser evolved life. And so his perspective was that a cabbage is less evolved than a cow. You know, for instance, and so, and because I guess it would be considered, you know, a greater sin to eat. And the more evolved the life form, the more of a affront to nature it is to kill it for, you know, purposes of nutrition.
Well, I do know that in India there are some religions where when you die you can have your body placed on a tower for the
animals to eat.
Yeah, and I wish I could do that. I don't know if I could orchestrate it.
I think it might go against California law.
It will. But you know, it's wonderful how there's so many viewpoints and perspectives, and we all have different beliefs.
Oh yeah, and you know, I'm aware that I'm not saying that I've got the truth here, and you know, you don't or something. I'm just saying. The differences in our perspectives make for some interesting conversation.
That. Yes, yes.
You know,
I appreciate that. Yes.
But who knows what's really happening? I mean, okay. I think we've exhausted the animal conversation, and I just wanted to touch on that since, you know, we talked about it so much in the previous interview. So, anything you'd like to conclude with?
Just gratitude. Just really appreciate being here.
Mm-hmm.
Appreciate being able to share this with the people who are listening. Appreciate. Thank you for letting me go through my cynical wave that came up this morning. I thought, why am I having an interview when I'm thinking these thoughts? Mm. But I think it was a good thing, because I think that we all, or it can be used as a good thing, because we all go through this. And now's the time that we can go deeper into our love, deeper into our gratitude, deeper into the question, what do we really wish to contribute to this planet that we all share? So,
great. Well, thanks, Laurie. Let me make my usual concluding remarks. You've been watching an interview with Dr. Laurie Moore, and this interview is one in a continuing series. There have been nearly 200 of them so far, and there will be 200 more, or more than that, if I have anything to say about it. So you can find them all archived on batgap.com, B-A-T-G-A-P. There also you'll find, well, there's two ways of finding them. They're alphabetical listing and chronological listing. I have about 1,000 people, literally, on the waiting list who have either been recommended to me or have contacted me themselves. And I apologize to anyone whom I have not yet been able to schedule. My standard response to people is, oh great, sounds wonderful, I'd really like to do it, and I'll put you on the list, and you know, don't hold your breath because it may take a while before I can schedule you. But it's by no means meant to be a sort of a judgment on your worthiness to be interviewed or the worthiness of the person you may have recommended to me to interview. All right, that was a bit of a diversion, but I just want to say it. Also, you'll find on backgap.com a place to be notified by email each time a new interview is posted. There's a tab there, a donate button, which, by virtue of which I am able to be at this conference today, so I really appreciate people donating if and when they can. And a discussion group. Each interview has its own discussion group in this forum that we've set up, and the discussion has become quite lively. One thing is, to see the discussions that are in there, you may need to register on the site. There's a way of sort of registering. Somebody just brought it to my attention the other day that they went into the discussion for David Godman and didn't see any discussion. And then they registered and saw pages and pages of discussion. So we're going to try to fix that so that you can see the discussion even without registering. But in the meanwhile, if you go there, you've got to register to see the discussion. There's also an audio podcast. You know, people don't have time to sit in front of their computers and watch long interviews, but if you'd like to just listen to the audio, you'll find a link in every interview for the audio podcast. You can subscribe on iTunes. And also, I'll have more about Laurie on her page when I put up this interview, a little bio of her, links to her website, books, and so on, if you'd like to get in touch with Laurie. You do sort of little sessions with people over Skype as well as in person?
I do.
And phone. And you're kind of an animal communicator. And we had a little session with you talking about our animals. And the first one especially that you did was kind of uncanny. I mean, you came out with some stuff that would have been hard to guess.
Oh, good.
And it was impressive. So, thanks for listening and watching, and we'll see you next time. Next time's going to be soon, because I have two or three of these planned during my visit here at the conference. Thanks.